Welcome, I'm Michael Pierce, and this is The Human Condition. Today we're talking about Chapter 3, the technical background of the EEG and ERP for complementary alternative and functional medicine practitioners and their patients. Lastly, we have to talk a little bit technically about what to expect for site preparation. Whether you're a patient who's about to get an EEG or whether you're a technician who's about to perform an EEG or a QEEG, there are some things that have to go into site preparation. And the site preparation is not just the site of the head where we're putting an electrode, but it's the whole site of where the patient is. So the first thing we want to do is make sure that we have enough room for the patient and the clinician to walk around, that we don't have a lot of wires in the way. There should be one wire that usually goes from the cap to the amplifier behind the patient and to the computer, and the rest of the floor should be clear and free of debris and purses and water bottles. We don't want, you know, phones. We don't want things underfoot so that people can trip and step on them. You also want the site to be well lighted. Even though the EEG process of data collection is probably a low light condition, we want the setup to be high light so that you can see what you're doing and you don't make mistakes and, you know, accidentally stab someone or accidentally, you know, do something silly and bump into them or hurt them somehow, or trip or fall on them or drop something on them. We want to make sure that we have a clean and dry area. We don't want any water. There can't be any water on the floor. There can't be standing water. There can't be damp carpets. There can't be dripping ceilings. We have to make sure there's no water anywhere. We want to make sure that if the person does have a container, that it's completely sealed, one like this where it's completely sealed and there's no possibility of spilling because there's a valve on it, as opposed to a container like this that's a can that could pour. And we want to make sure that our patients had a chance to go to the bathroom, that they've had a chance to do that and be ready for the scan. We want to make sure that the technician is also ready and capable of doing their job. In this environment of COVID, we often are wearing masks most of the time, both the patient and the clinician, and we're washing our hands all the time, and we're washing the seat, and we're washing the chair and the handrails and the table. There will usually be a computer station for EEG collection and QEEG collection. We don't want the patient to be looking at a screen that has movement on it because we don't want their eyes distracted by movement. So we usually move the laptop or the monitor screen away from the patient or rotate the patient's chair so that they are not looking at a screen. The patient will be usually doing 10 minutes of eyes closed and 10 minutes of eyes open, but there are variations of this. Some systems use 2 or 4 minutes, and that's perfectly okay, depending on what they're doing. Further, for site preparation, we want to make sure that the temperature is right. Mostly, we want to make sure that it's cool enough. One of the biggest problems that we have in EEG collection is too hot or too humid. If the room is too hot or too humid, we will get something called a sweat artifact on the scalp. And this happens usually when a room is creeping up. It starts out with the guys, and very often it'll be the guys with a bald head or a shaved head. Their scalp will get really hot and start to sweat. And when they start to sweat, you get these big wavy lines of artifact, of not brainwaves happening on your screen. And so you don't really want to let the room get too hot. It's very important to keep the room cool enough and dry enough, not too humid, so that they can be in good shape. Now, with the advent of COVID, a lot of doctors are using air cleaners, air circulators, fans, and they're trying to do air exchange. Now, that's not bad. Usually these fans are not too noisy. The biggest problem is electrical noise, not auditory noise. So we have to make sure that we're not picking up a 60-cycle hum in the United States or a 50-cycle in Europe or somewhere else. We don't want to see electrical noise come across from the power source of a fan or an air circulator or an air purifier. And also, you don't want to run ozone during the patient's visit. Ozone is always done with no one in the room, and you let the ozonator run, and then the ozonator has to dissipate after it's off for a number of minutes, anywhere from 20 minutes to an hour or longer before people can enter the room, because you don't want patients breathing or anyone breathing ozone pure from an ozone machine. The ozone should be distributed in the room. It should dissipate, and then you enter the room at an appropriate time after the ozone. You don't want to run an ozonator during the therapy. So watch out for fans and the noise of fans and the noise of other medical devices and machines, computers, amplifiers, power bricks for laptops and other computers, the tower of a computer. You just want to make sure that you run an EMF detector around your office, and you know, sometimes you can use an EMF detector app on your phone. I have actual dedicated EMF detectors, machines that you can buy as part of a voltmeter, ohmmeter, ammeter. They cost between $40 and $50. You can buy them at any hardware store. They're just a little more expensive voltmeter, but they have an EMF detector on them, and you can point them at lights and different objects and see if there's a stray electrical field that might be messing up your brainwave collection. So that's part of the site preparation. You also want to make sure that you explain to the patient and when they walk in, if they've never seen your equipment, it's nice to have your barrel and needle covered before they see it, because you don't want people to walk into a room that are not familiar with the procedure and see a giant barrel syringe filled with electrogel and a needle that looks like a horse needle, because they don't understand what this is and they're thinking, oh my God. And in fact, some people I've seen, they take this giant syringe, which is very convenient, and they put it into the cap, and the patient or their relative screams, thinking that they're going to get an injection in their brain. This is so far from the truth, but we have to tell people ahead of time what to expect before they see the equipment. So we want to explain to them, first of all, there will be no electricity going into you. There's only electricity coming out of your brain, and it's very small electromagnetic waves that come out of everyone's brain normally. Mine is emitting them right now, hopefully. Yours is emitting them right now. Everybody's emitting little brain waves that come out of our skulls, and all we're going to do is capture them and collect them. Not really, but we're going to just detect them, and they're going to trigger some movement of electrons inside our cap that's going to go through a wire, that's going to go through an amplifier, that's going to go into our computer, and we're going to measure and catalog and statistically analyze all of these data. And it's not diagnostic. An EEG and ERP is not diagnostic, or QEEG is not diagnostic in the context of functional medicine. We are not doing a hospital-based neurological epileptiform analysis of EEG in a neurological office where they have a crash cart. We're not doing that. This is a non-diagnostic QEEG procedure that's designed to measure departures from wellness. It's not designed to diagnose epilepsy or sleep disorder. In modern medicine, EEG is designed to measure epilepsy and seizure disorder and sleep disorders and brain problems, but not what we're doing. This is a different thing. So we want to explain to them, no electricity is going into your head. This is not a diagnostic procedure. And lastly, you're going to see what looks like a needle. It's not a needle. What it is an applicator that is dull. And what it does is it puts salt water into the cap, not into your head. So you're going to feel a little bit of cool salt water on your scalp at different points, and you're going to feel a little scratchy as I rub your head and try to debride some of the skin cells so I get a good contact. I have to roughen up and push off some of the skin cells on your ear lobe and on your scalp on different points so that I can get good conduction and pick up the brain waves. So you're going to see what looks like a syringe, and it's not designed to give you a shot. So nobody's going to break any skin. You're not getting any punctures, you're not getting any shots today. It's extremely important to explain that to somebody before they see it. Then, of course, I show them everything and I say, this is our equipment we're gonna use today. I like to show them the bottles. I like to show them, this is the paste. This is the electrogel. It looks like this. It's just salt water. It won't stain your clothes. In most cases, it won't stain clothes. And I may drip some on you. I like to warn them that I may drip some on you if you have a very, very, very expensive like silk shirt or you're wearing a suit. Maybe we should drape you first, or maybe we should not have that suit on, or maybe we should do something different or let you change clothes. Give them the option if they've got some very expensive clothing that might stain. Most clothing will not stain. This shirt would not stain, and the stuff would come right out of it. So the site preparation involves making sure that the floor I usually start with the floor and work my way up. Is the floor safe? Is the chair and the table safe? Is the room temperature right? Is the electrical environment of the room right? Is there any water in the room? Is there any thing we would trip on? You know, is all of the equipment out and readily available? Is there a trash can readily available? Because you're going to generate a lot of little stuff that you got to toss. And also you're going to want towels and paper towels and other things to wipe your hands with. And now with COVID, hand sanitizer. I actually like to have a little bit of extra supplies. I like to have an extra set of ear clips because sometimes they break. Sometimes they rust and they don't work and you can't see that. I also like to have an extra mask in case my mask breaks, because I can't continue the procedure if my mask snaps or breaks or something happens, or I drop it on the floor. I want to make sure that I have all the fluids available and I have all the electrodes available. I want to make sure that before I start that everything is clean, and usually it's been cleaned, you know, the previous day or previous week, because you know, you should end all your procedures with cleaning. so that you put everything away clean. You never put anything away dirty. So everything is clean and sanitized, and you still want to check over your instruments and make sure they're all working. You also want to make sure your software is working. I can tell you that there have been times that my software has not been working, and I didn't check it ahead of time, and I boot it up, turn it on, and all of a sudden there's something wrong, and I need to deal with a software issue. So check your software and your hardware and your equipment and all of your cleanliness. We like to use alcohol wipes, and so I have alcohol wipes as well as paper towels, sometimes to clean surfaces, as well as wipes. And that can be cheaper than buying a bunch of pre-made wipes, because wipes can get expensive. You can also use various sprays. There are different types of sprays. Some are quaternary ammonia sprays that are highly toxic, but they are very effective. And there are also different bleach-based sprays that are made from salt water, where you can, you know, ionize salt and water and make a mild sodium hypochlorite solution that's very, very safe for people to use, and you can spray it on different materials. So there's lots and lots of options for cleanliness and site preparation, but you have to put some time and thought into what you're doing. And if you have a technician, it's a good idea to make a checklist ahead of time. I think it should be laminated and hung on the wall. I like to make these laminated signs, and the patient doesn't have to see it, but it can be, you know, out of the way, a laminated document, and it would have a checklist, and maybe they could even use a grease pencil or wax pencil and check it off as they go, especially when they're beginning. Sometimes you can do it visually. I believe in checklists an awful lot. I think the Checklist Manifesto is a fantastic book, and I think it's very useful in business and in clinical science and in clinics. So site preparation should be considered quite a lot with the preparation for EEG and QEEG. There's a lot that goes into this. It's a medical procedure that the patient considers very important and highly technical, and it's a chance for you to demonstrate how much you care about your patients by making sure that everything is clean and smooth and practiced. If you're in a new room that you've never used before, it's nice to go through and just practice in the room. I do a mobile practice, and many times I do rounds, and I end up in a place that's new for me, and I've never used it before. And you can be quite clumsy if it's your first time using a room based on where all the surfaces are, the desks and the heights and the chairs, and, you know, where does your computer go? Where is the patient? How do you step around them? Where is the garbage can? All those things are something to consider when you do your work. So practice, just like a chef would do, practice doing your procedure and going through the motions of capping the patient and you know, putting the gel in, and go through the motions. Spend a few minutes if you're in a new location, so you don't feel so clumsy and look goofy. And then cleanliness is the big deal, especially with this whole COVID world. We really need to pay attention to cleanliness, because there is some small risk of passing something on to a patient. I like to demonstrate to patients that I'm opening a brand new needle and I'm disposing of it at the end in a sharps container. The site preparation is the end of our discussion on technical background. There is an endless amount of information we could talk about, but that's a good enough for this particular session. We may do more later.